FSN Radio. It's all about what's next. Go to financialsurvivalnetwork.com and sign up for your free weekly newsletter. You'll also get 3 free reports. The Financial Survival Network. It's all about what's next.
And we are back on the Financial Survival Network. So real estate, you know, it's been really big for the past few years. What's the state of the market? Is it too late for you to get in? Well, we need to figure that out. That's why we've got Jason Hartman on with us now of jasonhartman.com. Jason, welcome back.
Hey, thank you, Kerry.
Hey, so look, you know, a lot of these big markets, the go-go markets, as they call them, you know, New York, LA, Miami, they've really overheated. I mean, you know, I think a broom closet in New York City goes for over $1 million now, right?
It is absurd. I interviewed one of the top brokers in New York City on one of my shows about 3 weeks ago, and she happens to be Ukrainian. So we were talking a lot about Ukraine and Russia and how that is impacting the New York City market, which it really is, okay? And, you know, people always have, you know, historically around the world looked to America as the Brinks truck, if you will, as a safe, stable place with rule of law to put their money. Now, you know, I think, you know, America ain't what it used to be, as the saying goes, but it's still, you know, comparatively to the rest of the world, it's pretty awesome. And it's amazing. I mean, people in New York City think they're investors when what they really are is they're just total gamblers. They're complete speculators. So let me give you an example. Yeah. Her typical investment property is a $3 million condo that's about 1,400 square feet.
Yeah.
Built in 2004-ish, somewhere around there. And that $3 million condo will rent for $10,000 per month.
That's about right.
Yeah, it's about right, but it's also about terrible because, you know, if any of your people have listened to me before on prior episodes of your show, I always say that the metric, the easy rule of thumb when you're an investor to clear your head and not to deceive yourself or not to be deceived by others is what I call the RV ratio, the rent to value ratio. And it's incredibly simple, Kerry. It's 1%. That's the target. So, you know, a $3 million place should rent for $30,000 per month. If someone came to us and they went to jasonhartman.com and they found 30 $100,000 properties, they might diversify those into 3 different markets, and they would get anywhere between $28,000 and $36,000 or $38,000 per month in income from those properties. And their eggs wouldn't all be in one basket. And they wouldn't have incredibly high homeowners association dues like you do with those New York City condos. I mean, they're just enormously expensive.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and they'd be diversified. I mean, it's just crazy that people consider that investing. The go-go markets have never worked for real, legitimate, prudent investing. Okay. They work for speculators. They work for gamblers. You know, I'm a almost California native. The vast majority of my life, grew up in Los Angeles. As an adult, I lived in Orange County, Irvine, Newport Beach areas. And those markets just never work. They just never work in the up market, in the down market. You cannot get cash flow that makes sense in those markets.
It's musical chairs, right? I mean,
it is.
Because you got to hope that that you get the chair before the music stops. Because if you don't, then you're going to lose money or you're going to wind up losing the property, right?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, it's musical chairs. It's also known as the greater fool theory. No matter what I pay for this property, some greater fool will come along and pay more later. And, you know, that has been proven to be a failure of a strategy many, many times just since I've been in the business and been through a few cycles myself. And, you know, these go-go markets, they got pretty hot about a year ago, and we're already seeing them cool down. You know, people are smart enough to know, most of them at least, that when it's a much better deal to rent a house in that market than own a house in that market, they stop buying. And rightfully so, as they should. I mean, you know, in Southern California, you can rent a $600,000 house for about $2,000 a month versus, you know, you could be that renter there and you'd be getting the better deal, just like the New York, the Manhattan high-end condo. And that's not even really high-end in Manhattan. That's just, you know, 1,400 yeah. square feet. Okay.
That's a nice size two-bedroom apartment. It's no I great mean, shakes.
For $3 million, give me a break, you know?
We're talking, okay.
talking incredibly expensive.
You probably know, $2,000
a square foot. Yeah. And yeah. so, you know, you'd be much better off to rent a property in the high-end market and enjoy the lifestyle it offers and buy multiple lower-end rental properties in diverse markets nationwide. And you're basically arbitraging the real estate market. You're exploiting the differences in these markets. So I always like to say, Carrie, one of my famous sayings is invest in properties that make sense, so you can afford to live in places that don't make sense.
And New York City is certainly one of them. And, you know, what's going on with the U.S. and Russia probably going to have an impact on the Miami market, because that was like a huge Russian, I don't know if the organized crime or what, but huge Russian immigrant market. Huge.
Right. Yeah.
And it's probably cooling it down as a result. And a great article in Zero Hedge about how the People's Bank of China, that's their central bank, was pretty much allowing them to launder money out of China to buy luxury properties around the world, but primarily in the United States, to pretty much ease off inflation in China. Mm-hmm. And now that came out, so they stopped that for a while.
But, right.
You know, all these things, that's the problem with investing in the high-end luxury market, because you've got all these things going on. So I think your strategy, time-proven, time-honored, and, you know, you got ways to make money in any kind of market, whether it's inflationary, deflationary, or just what we might be having now, stagflationary, right?
Right, absolutely. You know, if you look at the rates of inflation versus single family home prices, and you know, I did a conference recently where I talked about this, and this chart that I used went from 1980 to 2009, and you see that most of the time, real estate is really just keeping up with inflation. And then when it gets crazy in one of these psychotic bubble markets, you know, the housing prices go way above inflation, and then they regress back down in the go-go markets, as you put it. And those include virtually all of California, a lot of the expensive areas in the Northeast. They include Miami. They include higher-end properties in places like Chicago, okay, and those things. And then those markets, they fall and they have their collapse. It's like the chart looks like a roller coaster ride, okay? And, you know, what happens is, real estate really, in nominal dollars, looks better than it is. Because when you look at it in real dollars versus inflation, it pretty much treads water most of the time. Okay, it's not that incredible until you add some of the other multidimensional characteristics to the investment. And a couple of those are, number one, leverage. So let's say that the real inflation rate is 5% annually. Okay. Now, the government is, of course, telling us at that same time, whenever it's 5%, the government will tell us it's 2%, but we know better. You know,
I believe them. I really believe them.
you're being sarcastic, right?
A little bit.
Yeah.
A touch.
and one of the ways, you know, for listeners that may not have thought a lot about this, of the way unemployment is manipulated, the unemployment numbers, GDP is manipulated, inflation rates are manipulated through the consumer price indexes. The major mechanisms by which the government manipulates the inflation rate are weighting, substitution, and hedonic indexing. Mm-hmm. Okay, those are the three big ways they manipulate. So the substitution one is a great example. They'll say, okay, well, if the price of beef goes way up, they'll just switch beef out in the index for chicken. And, you know, maybe you don't like chicken. Maybe you think chicken is a dirty bird, okay?
You know? Yeah, then and, you have fish. If right, chicken yeah, gets well, too expensive,
exactly,
eat fish.
Yeah, so they substitute and they manipulate. And so the inflation rates, there's big incentives for the government to understate the true rate of inflation, okay? And so, you know, say 5% and say the real estate appreciates at a rate of 5% too, okay? So it looks like you're just treading water until you throw leverage into the mix. And, you know, typically an investor might put 20% down on a property. Maybe they'll put 25% down. But let me just use 20%, the best case scenario there. So now they've got a 5-to-1 leverage ratio. So what they get to do is they now get to outpace inflation with a multiplier effect. So their investment, and we'll use that $100,000 property as an example, they've got $20,000, and of course I'm rounding here, you know, there's closing costs and so forth, but just to conceptually tell people, they'll put $20,000 down on the $100,000 property, and it appreciates at 5%. You don't get appreciation just on your $20,000. You get it on the entire $100,000. So you get $5,000 appreciation annually. But, you know, the flaw here is that, well, Jason, you know, you've got an $80,000 mortgage, so you've got debt on the property. Well, I love and I hate debt. I hate it if I have to pay it, but I love it if I can outsource it to someone else called a tenant. And in with income property, we don't pay our own debts. The tenants pay our debts for us. So that's a great thing. And we get to exceed the rate of inflation by a multiplier effect there. We get to outdo inflation, not just keep pace with it, but we get to multiply it times 5 in terms of our return. So that's just one of the many multiple dimensions of income property. Of course, we're going to add to that cash flow. We're going to add to that tax benefits. Income property is the most tax-favored asset in America, bar none. And, you know, a whole bunch of other great things like having control over your investment, not having some fund manager skim all the profits off the top before you get the return. So, you know, just fantastic multi-dimensional characteristics available to investors.
Yep. And so inflation, you're doing okay. What about deflation? If we ever had such a thing, which we've had little bouts of it, but I haven't seen much of it happen.
Nothing long-term in the deflation. Well, first of all, when I did this recent presentation, I looked at three possible scenarios: inflation, deflation, and stagnation, okay? And in an inflationary environment, my strategy is a home run. It's just awesome. And I think inflation is the most likely long-term trend, because with inflation, another aspect I didn't even mention is that we basically get paid to borrow the money when we leverage our properties, because the real value of that mortgage is debased by inflation. Just like, in a bad way, our savings account is debased by inflation. Our stock and bond portfolios are debased by inflation. They become worth less. Our debt becomes worth less. And that's good for us. The other things, that's bad for us. But thankfully, inflation does pay off, in essence, pay off our debts for us. So in a deflationary scenario, the value of our debt actually rises. So that would be bad. It's the opposite effect, right? On its face, it looks bad. But when you really look at it, the great thing about income property is it always gives you choices, because it's multidimensional, to adjust your strategy for the current economic environment. So if we're in an inflationary environment, and it turns into a bubble market, and prices get really stupid and frothy, like they did you know, this last go around before the last economic crisis. And then, you know, in some of the go-go markets, we're having that situation now where it's getting pretty frothy. It's not as bad as it was in, you know, 2004, 2005 yet, but it's getting a little frothy for sure. And so you sell the property and take a capital gain, and you can alleviate the tax burden on any capital gain by doing a 1031 tax deferred exchange. So you constantly defer your taxes, and then you eventually pass your properties on to your heirs. And when you do that, under current law, the basis steps up to market value. So it's the most beautiful estate planning vehicle ever invented. Okay. You know, income property is just, it's the most tax favored asset in America in so many ways. So in a deflationary environment, what we would do is we'd want to adjust our strategy and just hold on, just be there in the ride, keep our properties rented, and there investors can't get yield out of anything. And that's what we're seeing now. Even though we're not really in a deflationary environment, we could argue that this is a stagnation type environment that we're in. It kind of depends, you know, what your own personal consumer price index is, how you spend your own money, and it depends who you talk to. There are varying opinions as always, but in a deflation or stagnation environment, you got to get yield. There's just no place to get yield. Right now, for example, you know, Wall Street is, I think it's pretty much a bubble. The bond market is a disaster.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. I mean, look at PIMCO. My God. I mean, Bill Gross even came out and, you know, I think this is so disingenuous, you know, even though I like reading Bill Gross's stuff, you know, but I like this, you know, he said he profited dramatically off of, you know, poor and middle-class people. And now he feels guilty about it. And I'm like, well, Bill, give the money back.
Yeah. He could remedy that situation pretty easily, Bill.
You sure could. Yeah. You know, let's not play any violins for Bill Gross. Okay. But the bond market's a disaster. It gets killed by inflation, certainly. Okay. And, you know, you can't get yield anywhere. So the best yield is in the income property. You get cash flow yield. And in this example, under deflation, the type of yield I'm talking about here is about 14% annually. When you do the math, it's 14% annually. And you know what, Carrie? Because there's some numbers here, I think what we should do is we should put these slides up, and I will just share them with your audience so they can look at them till their heart's content. I'll just yank a few selected slides out of my presentation, and they can take a peek at them. At jasonhartman.com/LUTZ, LUTZ, your last name.
Great.
Okay.
Yeah, we'll put the link up.
Yeah. And there, deflation, 14% annual yield. Okay. Pretty phenomenal. And a stagnation scenario, 13%. But let me compare it to inflation. That's 35% annually in these projections that we ran. And these are pretty realistic. They include vacancy rates, management fees, realistic rental incomes. You know, someone listening may think, gosh, this guy, okay, 35%, that's just unrealistic. That's crazy.
Mm-hmm.
But it's not. With income property being the most historically proven investment in America, everybody listening knows somebody who created real long-term wealth with income property. And they probably don't know anybody who created real long-term wealth with stocks, bonds, or mutual funds, or any of the traded Wall Street-style assets. Mm-hmm. You know, it just doesn't work. And the beauty of the income property is that it's multi-dimensional. It's not flat, one- or two-dimensional. So let me tell you what I mean by that. So if you buy a non-dividend paying stock, it's one-dimensional. The only play is buy low, sell high. That's it. If you buy a property in a go-go market, it's one-dimensional because you're not going to get any cash flow. Well, you will get some tax benefits, So it is multidimensional, I guess. But really, your strategy is buy low, sell high. That's it. That's the speculator's mentality. It's the gambler's mentality. And it's the mentality where people lose their fortunes over and over again. Occasionally, people get lucky, but luck is not a strategy, okay?
Yeah.
You know, I always like to say, Kerry, luck is not. I'd rather be lucky than good any day of the week, but I can't count on luck, okay? So you got to be good. And so that's one-dimensional. If you buy a dividend-paying stock, it's two-dimensional. Buy low, sell high. That's one dimension, capital appreciation. And the other one is, of course, that income or those dividends. Precious metals, one-dimensional asset, okay? So all you're looking there for is buy low, sell high, okay? Or have a hedge against inflation and a store of wealth.
Right.
And, you know, we've talked about it before. I think metals are okay. I think they're a store of wealth. They're a savings account. They're not an
insurance policy.
Yeah, they're an insurance policy. They're not an investment strategy, okay? There is a difference between those two. Insurance, great. Have insurance, have savings, have a store of wealth, but again, not an investment strategy. That's different than investing, okay?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And you know, that's basically what it entails. So we'll get these slides up at jasonhartman.com/LUTs where people can look at these in more detail.
Yeah. It just makes a lot of sense. And yeah, especially now, because financial repression, it's one of the few avenues that are available to you to actually get cash flow and leverage cash flow without a heck of a lot of risk. Yeah. Is there a risk? You know, there's going to be risk. Wherever.
Of course there's risk. Yeah. Every investment has risk. Yeah.
But I think the risk here, it's a question of, is the risk manageable? Is it sensible, controllable? And, you know, that's what I look at when I look at any investment. Yep. And, you know, the leverage, you know, it's nothing new here. This isn't like exotic. Right. It's not like, I got this new product, which Wall Street's always coming up with new packaged products to separate you from your dollars and to put you into the poorhouse. Mm-hmm. You know, that's what they specialize in. This is what they
do.
And you could go back to, 100 years ago, and you'd be seeing the same kind of garbage as they do now. And you know what? You're always falling for it because it's always a get rich quick with a minimal of effort. Yours requires some effort here. You know, there is effort, there is work involved, but not a lot. You know, that's the good part.
Right, right. So, and I don't believe that there's any such thing as a passive investment, Kerry. Mm-hmm. There's really no such thing. We try to make investing in income property as passive as possible. Because of our infrastructure, because we've been doing this so long, and because of my personal vast experience as an investor, we really have simplified the process quite dramatically, where we provide management referrals. We exert a lot of leverage over the referrals of these property managers because we give them so much business. We have the opportunity to aggregate all of the weight and the buying power of all of our thousands of clients, okay, into something where our clients get exceptionally good service versus doing it themselves. So someone listening is thinking, oh gosh, you know, I don't want to manage properties. First of all, you don't have to manage them. In the projections I just made, all of the management fees were included in those. So you have property managers, you'll never get a phone call. Your tenants do not know who you are. They don't call you, okay? they don't have your email address. They don't know who you are. They don't send you the check. They send the check to the management company. And so we exert a lot of leverage over those managers because of our buying power. It's kind of like, you know, Walmart. We hear a lot about Walmart and how they, you know, they're really tough on their vendors because they want to bring the best products into their stores at the lowest possible prices. And that's really what we do, in essence. Same thing. We aggregate the buying power of all of our clients. Okay. So we do make it pretty darn simple. And the great thing is the investor is in control of it. You don't have some crooked CEO, you know, skimming all the profits off the top. You don't have a bunch of middlemen. You don't have, you know, an investment banker, a market maker, you know, a brokerage firm, you know, another management company. I mean, some of these brokerage firms, they are, it's such a complete ripoff. You know, I like to call Wall Street the modern version of organized crime because what they'll do is they'll take your money and invest it and they'll charge you a management fee. So they might charge you 1.5% per year on your portfolio. Mm-hmm. But then underneath that, they refer you to their friends and the people that pay them well manage other funds. And then you've got another layer of management. It's just disgusting. Yeah.
Well, on that note, Jason, we got to go.
All right.
Just give us the contact info where to get a hold of you.
Yeah. JasonHartman.com. That's JasonHartman.com. And you can look at properties there on our website. You can listen to my podcast, The Creating Wealth Show, which is almost at 400 episodes now. Wow. And that's available. We've got a lot of top-tier guests on there, as you do on your show. And that's available at jasonhartman.com or, of course, on iTunes or Stitcher Radio.
All right. And don't forget, you can get the link in the show notes to this interview on financialsurvivalnetwork.com. Sign up for the newsletter, get the first 5 chapters of my book, Forget Wall Street, Go for the Gold and Silver Too, for free. And Jason, we will talk with you again real soon. You be well.
Okay. Thanks, Gary. Happy investing.
FSN Radio. It's all about what's next. Go to financialsurvivalnetwork.com and sign up for your free weekly newsletter. You'll also get 3 free reports. The Financial Survival Network. It's all about what's next.